are. Truth Frequency Radio.
From the biggest little city in the world in the clear blue waters of Lake Tahoe, broadcasting from an undisclosed location in the Truckee River Valley on Truth Frequency Radio, this is the Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Caron. Good Sunday afternoon to you. Welcome to the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com, your protection from deception all across America, all around the world. The number to call in is 866-37-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-378-7884. I'd like to welcome all of my affiliates. We are now broadcasting live on ipmnation.com as well as kstartalkradio.com, which is a new Christian conservative network that actually picked up my show on the live stream. Really a pleasure and an honor to be broadcasting there as well. Also, WLIR Australia, the Pyramid One Channel 2 Network, iHeartRadio now. Man, that's so cool that TFR is on iHeartRadio. I'm just amazed at how TFR is growing, how my show is growing, and it's all thanks to you. Much love to you all. Much gratitude, absolutely. And then on YouTube, we're almost at 3,000 subscribers. Again, thank you so much for supporting the channel, supporting my efforts to get the truth out there and bring you some of the best activists and authors and experts as we explore what's really going on in the world and trying to open the eyes of our fellow brothers and sisters, because so many, their eyes are just closed. It's that cognitive dissonance. They just got their head in the ground. But people seem to keep flocking to these truth shows. And obviously, you know, we were labeled fake news and all this stuff going on in the media and the propaganda and the brainwashing. But there are people who are really starting to wake up to the fact that we are being lied to on so many different levels. And it's been going on for a very, very, very long time. And it's interesting to see how this is expanding and it's growing. And today we're going to continue our Flat Earth Weekend. We're going to have some more Flat Earth 101 discussion today. It's going to be a really, really good show, so stay tuned. We're going to be also talking again about the Flat Earth International Conference being held November 9th and 10th, 2017 in Raleigh, North Carolina. It's going to be a lot of fun. I actually will be going along with some other TFR hosts as well, Zen Garcia. We're going to have Rob Skiba over there, Jaron Campanella, Mark Sargent. It's going to be an awful lot of fun. Really looking forward to it. And we'll bring my guest on here, who really doesn't need any introduction, but we'll get to that in just a second. But today's broadcast contains truth. It may in whole or in part be intercepted, impeded, interrupted, stolen, stored, used, and misused by a broad set of intelligence agencies, hackers, professional thieves, government operatives, and creeps. But we are going to be having a lot of fun today. You know, like I said, my guest today doesn't really need any introduction. When it comes to people who are prominent in the truth movement, specifically within the Flat Earth truth movement, his videos, his research, and even his music is absolutely phenomenal. And I would like to welcome again to the show, ODD. How are you doing today, man?
Oh, excellent, man. I'm really glad to be back. Thanks.
Oh, it's great to have you, man. Hey, you know, I hope, you know, after our last show, man, they took your channel down like days afterwards, man. I felt horrible. I was like, oh my gosh, what happened there? Let's hope that doesn't happen today. How's the new channel going?
Oh, it's going great, man. I haven't had any issues like that whatsoever. And that is strange that happened. about a day or two after I was on your last show. I even had people trying to connect it to you, like it was Sean Caron. I was like, yeah, right. So, but anyway, I mean, I'm back at, I surpassed where I was on my last channel that they ripped down. So I'm good. I'm going on 40,000 subs. They ripped me down about 8-9 months ago at 36,000. So I'm back and I'm past that.
Well, that's awesome. You know, I did everything I could after that happened too. I started spreading it out and I started putting stuff out there saying, we got to get his subs back. We got to grow his channel again. And it's great to hear that it has surpassed the old channel, which was ODD TV. And the new one is called ODD Reality, correct?
Correct. Odd Reality, ODD. It's interchangeable in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. So I wanted to play a little bit of your music today. In fact, the last time we were on your you were on the show, we had some issues, but we've got those basically solved now. And I wanted to play a couple of tunes here today. And we're going to start with, let's see, I was going to think we were going to start with Dear NASA, Why Are You Lying? This is ODD. This is some of his truth music, and I love it an awful lot. In fact, I listen to this at least once a week. So check it out. This is ODD, Dear NASA. Space may be the final frontier, but it's made in a Hollywood basement. Space may be the final frontier, but it's made in a Hollywood basement. Space may be the final frontier, but it's made in a Hollywood basement. Space may be the final frontier, but it's made in a Hollywood basement. Have you ever dreamed of going up to outer space? Or maybe meeting other beings from another place? Have you ever wondered what it's like on other planets? Then you watch a science show and come to believe you understand it. You feel empowered by the knowledge and you feel enlightened. Listening to Bill Nye and Neil deGrasse Tyson. But then you wake up and you start to see the obvious. Life is just a lie and this whole world ain't what we thought it was. NASA's missions to the moon were never completed. They just filmed them in a room and people believe it. I used to wonder what it's like to be an astronaut. Now when I see them acting, I can't help but to laugh a lot. They give us cartoons and they claim that we live on a ball. But it's flat and it's not moving or spinning it all. Why you lying to us, man? That's something that we want to know. After that, you're gonna have to pack up all your stuff and go. History has been rewritten by winners of wars. The Jesuit order, Khazars, Freemasons, and more. They pulled the veil over our eyes, and it's time to awaken. Through organized indoctrination, our minds have been taken. It's time we take our power back and we rescue our people. The Vatican and the bankers are like Resident Evil. They may have had the greatest plan that was ever concocted, but Illuminati never thought that they'd ever be spotted. They're manufacturing reality all in our heads. They tell us if the earth is flat, then we'll fall off the edge. But if it is a spinning ball, we won't fall off it then. And gravity is our imaginary magic friend. Why is water always flat when unmanipulated? Why are pictures of the earth computer generated? Why you lying to us, man? That's something that we want to know. After that, you're gonna have to pack up all your stuff and go.
Becoming 100% crystal clear that you and the other space programs that are in operation are connected and are deceiving the entire world. More and more people are waking up every single day, and we are now able to see right through you. But what we really want to know is, why are you lying? Sincerely, me and the great people of this earth.
Space may be the final frontier, but it's made in a Hollywood basement.
That
the captain thinks the world is around, see? But we all know it's a flat, right?
Of course it's flat. Sure, I know the world is flat.
Yeah, so do I. Everybody knows that.
Now, that outro there is from the Flintstones, was it not, ODD?
Yeah, that was a little clip from the Flintstones.
Yeah, that was cool. Hey, have you seen the Bugs Bunny episode where it's a flat Earth episode and Bugs Bunny basically proves the Earth is round by throwing a ball in one direction and then turning around with his baseball glove and catching the ball coming the other direction, just plastered with stickers from various worldwide cities? Have you seen that episode?
I haven't.
You got to check it out. I mean, I remember seeing this as a kid, but you know, and it starts off with the guy saying, oh, the thing's a globe. And the guy's, no, it's flat. And he bashes him on the head. And then Bugs Bunny actually is trying to prove that it is a globe by throwing the baseball. That's about as absurd as what NASA and the powers that be is telling us as far as proving that the world is a sphere.
Absolutely. That's funny. I'm going to look that up.
Yeah, you got to check it out, man. In fact, I saw it the other day because I got an old Bugs Bunny video for my kid, and I was watching it, and I started just cracking up. You know, we're going to do Flat Earth 101 today, and I want to go over a lot of stuff with you as far as, you know, the things that make it apparent to most of us who are now looking at this issue and seeing that it is very, very possibly a flat plane. In fact, I don't know if you know this or not, but I came out yesterday and finally said, you know what, I'm flat. Until NASA turns a telescope around or something from one of these apparent or alleged satellites and shows me something different, I'm flat, man.
Beautiful, man. That is excellent news. Congratulations. It's good to get that off your chest sometimes. I mean, when you get to that point and you're starting to feel it, that's how I was. And I had this kind of, you know, a few days where I was like, should I let people know that I'm flat or not? And I was scared. And finally, when I did it, it's been all nothing but good, you know, good stuff ever since.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I've been saying that I'm a baller skeptic for a long time, and I have justified not coming out and saying that I'm flat, mostly because of all the other things that I talk about, GMO foods, chemtrails, fluoride, vaccines, all of the truths that people need to awaken to, that many of them are ready for things like GMO foods and are ready for things like vaccines and health and wellness and the allopathic healthcare conspiracy. I want them to be able to grab those things, but there are many people who are still not ready to break the indoctrination, this embedded idea that we're living on a spinning ball. And we're going to get into that today. And in fact, I want to just open the show, and I want to thank Charlie, because this is exactly how I was going to open the show. And he asked it in the chat room, why is the shape of the planet so important?
Well, I would say that, you know, the first thing is that they've been showing us and telling us and teaching us and our kids that the Earth is a sphere spinning and flying through outer space. You know, this is a fact. This is what they tell us, teach us, show us. This is what we get images of from NASA, although they admit that they're composites, meaning that they're made up from many different sources and whatnot. But so we're giving NASA billions of dollars each year to keep lying to us. It's taxpayer money, you know, and they don't turn up anything real when it comes to science. They don't practice science. They never show, for instance, they don't have any of their experiments to prove that there's a vacuum up there. You know, it's a fact that space is a vacuum, yet there's not one kind of experiment that you could look into or see how they found that out. And stuff like that I find interesting, but that's first, okay? So after that, the most important thing, if you could get to this point of realization, is that they're basically hiding the divine nature of mankind and the truth that you could find in the Bible about how this place was made and what it actually is, you know, a flat level stationary plane that's enclosed by a crystalline canopy, you know, AKA the firmament, the dome. All this stuff seems radical when you haven't heard it, if you're just hearing it for the first time. But once you start really seeing that NASA is indeed lying to us, taking our money, teaching us that the Earth is a spinning ball flying through outer space, and then you've realized that, you know, they're what are they hiding about the nature of God, creation, you know. This stuff, it gets bigger and more important the more you expound upon these lies. But you have to first come to the understanding that, you know, we're being lied to, and they're showing us the spinning ball all the time. And they even admit when they show it to us that it's not, it's CGI or an artist rendition. And they say this, and they it says it in the small print. So those are just a couple of things that I could think of.
Yeah, my answer to him initially was, and right off the bat, I don't know that it's so much about the shape of the Earth, whether it's a cube, a sphere, a flat plane, or a disc, or whatever it might be, but the overall underlying matter here is the deception and why they're doing that. And I have come to the conclusion, ODD, that as I've researched more and more of it, and I've also researched things like the elite and how they are manipulating our reality, getting into things like CERN and obviously going deep into biblical study, is that they are in fact, and have been for a long time, trying to destroy the credibility of the Bible, destroy the divinity of mankind, destroy the special nature and his creation so that we basically turn from him.
That, yeah. And then we could spend our lives feeling insignificant, like we don't matter, that we're on some sort of accidental situation where we got lucky enough to be on this spinning ball flying through outer space, but it's all for naught, you know, there's no purpose behind it. So you get that in your head, and then you just kind of say, you know, not only are you pushed extremely far, if not all the way away from the creator and his intentions for us, you end up, you know, you could sin casually. I'm not even religious, but you could just be a terrible person and justify it by nothing matters.
Yeah, it really takes the morality out of humanity. And that's a disturbing thing. I've seen that happening so more and more and more. I mean, we see people just going off the hook crazy. And it's concerning to me because I think many people have, they have lost touch with the fact that God is real. The creation was real. We are here for a purpose. We are here for a reason. But many people have gotten into despair and this lack of hope. So they're just kind of going off the deep end. And I think really, in my opinion, I think that's what the elite want. They want everybody in a state of dis-ease or disease.
Yes, that's absolutely true. And they want the, I mean, it just seems like since the 1900s have came around and with the invention or, you know, the creation of Hollywood and all that, that the morals of people, not only in America, but especially America, but all over the world, the morals of people have declined, and we are just becoming, we justify all the time now, just transgender people, transvestites. Like, this is all, this world is just soon going to be exactly what they wanted. We're not going to be reproducing. We're not going to be having anything normal, and we're all going to be paying homage to their dualistic Baphomet God that they worship. You know, we're going in the entire wrong direction, and we're being led there. And that's what people need to understand.
Yeah. And that's, you know, your research, your videos, and everything you've done about Flat Earth is completely awesome to bring people. And this is one of the things that blows me away, ODD, is that there are militant atheists who are coming back to God. And I know you're not a Christian, but you side with your Christian brethren. And obviously, we're all looking at the Bible. We're going, wait a minute, this, it says right here that the thing is flat, like Pastor Dino Odle yesterday was talking to us about. But I see militant atheists coming back to God and coming back to morality and coming back to the fact that they got purpose. And again, I don't care what shape the earth is, but if it's bringing people back to the reality that we are special in nature and we're not some cosmic coincidence from some cosmic soup, I think it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, and I must say that, you know, before Flat Earth, I was totally a zeitgeist guy. I was on board with Zeitgeist, and I was totally like, this is the best documentary ever. It just goes to show that we don't matter, and religion is absolute BS. But I gotta say, brother, with each and every day that goes by, and the more I watch the works of my awesome Christian brothers and sisters, like Rob Skiba, I feel a closer connection to God. I'm already a creationist. I believe that we are created. I believe there is a God or gods, creators. I'm not trying to mislead people or be wrong here. But again, every day I'm getting closer to I'm thinking about like giving, you know, my life to Jesus Christ, man. I really am, because the more I look at it, I'm starting to see that this is all just one big spiritual battle taking place down here. And the only things that hold me back is like, I read the Bible and I find these parts that are like, you know, women aren't allowed to touch anything when they're on their menstrual cycle, or Romans 13, where it says you should obey your government. That's what God wants you to do, is obey your government, stuff like that. That's where I'm like, okay, so has the Bible been tampered with by Freemasons or, you know, some other type of way? But I do, for the most part, I believe that the Bible is the book of knowledge, man, for man. And I do believe that it could have been tampered with, but the stuff in there about the earth and the firmament, it's just all so real to me that I just get so, I get so much closer, this much closer to actually just taking that next step in my, my spiritual journey, if you will.
Praise God, brother. You're giving me chills right now. And that's just a beautiful thing. I mean, you are surrounded by some heavy Christians and good people like Rob Skiba, Zen Garcia, Robbie Davidson. And it's going to be awesome when we all going to meet up in November. I can't wait for the Flat Earth International Conference coming up November 9th and 10th, 2017. You're going to open it up, aren't you not?
Yeah, I'm starting the first hour with the Flat Earth 101. That's what I've become known you know, by a lot of the people in the community, is that I'm persistent with putting out almost every time I talk about Flat Earth, I always give a enough background to where someone new to the subject wouldn't stumble upon it and say, oh, well, you know, what the heck? I have no idea what he's talking about, you know, because I see this happening with a lot of awesome researchers, but that, you know, they're advanced. They're making an entire video that's on an advanced subject to do with Flat Earth or something like that. And if somebody was to not understand what we're on about in the first place, they would not get that. So I always reiterate the Flat Earth basics, so as to get people on board. And I've become known, you know, people are always like, oh, your videos are the ones that I share with people so they could get started, because it's necessary to have those kind of videos. I'm still working on some now, but yes, I'm doing the first hour at the conference, been invited by Robbie Davidson, very happy. Started working on my, PowerPoint presentation immediately as soon as I heard the news.
Yeah, and Robbie was like, man, he's a warrior. He's out there doing it. And I'm really looking forward to seeing that. Looking forward to all of us getting together in Raleigh, North Carolina, and doing this Flat Earth International Conference, because and it looks good grief. It looks like we're going to have I was talking to Robbie yesterday. We were talking about over 850 people is what we're looking at.
Oh, yeah, I'm probably going to I've never done a presentation in front of that many people. You know, I'm used to just doing my YouTube thing, but I'm very passionate about the Flat Earth, and I would go out in front of an audience 10 times that size. But yes, that's a lot of people. I'm excited. I hope I perform well and everything goes good. But it's insane. And there's people bashing it, saying, you know, we're just trying to make money. And then there's people that are highly supportive. But you just got to look at this. You know, there's conferences taking place every day about something, and nobody else complains about them. The first ever Flat Earth conference comes around and, you know, the world is up in arms, going crazy, but it's going to be epic and revolutionary.
Yeah. I saw the word trolls, hundreds of times, in the last week when, it's funny when every time I do a Flat Earth show or I start talking about Flat Earth, how many people drop off of my Facebook page. But, you know, hey, it's okay. You know, and eventually, hopefully they will come to the realizations that I have. And I just wanted to mention, because we're going to do Flat Earth 101 in the next segment. We're going to play some more music as well. And we're going to talk about the basics of Flat Earth. But, you know, just recently, I guess his first name, I'm not sure, I'm not a big basketball follower, so, but Kyrie Irving's claims here that the Cleveland Cavaliers superstar has recently the talk of social media leading up to the NBA All-Star game for sharing his belief that the earth is flat on Road Tripping with RJ and Channing podcast. I found that absolutely amazing. We had an NBA All-Star here saying the earth is flat.
Yeah, it's always great to get the attention, but I always look at these situations and go, what's going on? Are they rolling this stuff out, or are they, you know, are they making it to where it's these rappers and these, you know, these jocks, if you will, coming out with this belief, you know, and then getting clowned nonstop by the mainstream media? I just wonder how it's all working, what the mechanics of it are, if it's authentic, like if it's genuinely authentic or if it's being rolled out. Kyrie Irving has a all-seeing eye tattooed on his arm, on his bicep, and Russian Vids pointed that out, and that's because at first I wasn't thinking nothing of it. I was like, this is just absolutely great. And then Russian Vids kind of got me going, like, man, yeah, what, why? Why does he have the stuff on his arm? But you know what? All the attention is good. Some people are going to look into it and find good videos right away, and then we'll get some more people on board. And then some people are going to look into it and find, unfortunately, they're going to find like Flat Earth Society website answers first, which will completely put them off probably forever.
Yeah, I agree with you. And it's funny you mentioned about the manipulation within the Flat Earth movement and even anything else. You know, I said the same thing yesterday about Ashton Kutcher coming out in front of Congress and talking about pedophilia and child sex trafficking and human sex trafficking. And I had made the point, I said, it's hard to listen to Ashton knowing his character Kelso from That 70s Show and take him seriously. But at the same time, I was wondering about Ashton Kutcher and whether that was real or that was fabricated or contrived.
Sure. I don't know much about that, but absolutely. And he was like a Abercrombie and Fitch baby-faced shirtless model for years. So I'm sure he would have some insight on it. And what gets me is that it always takes like a star, like, you know, a sports star, a rap star, a Hollywood star in order for people to turn their heads and pay attention. So it's like, man.
Hold that thought. We're going to go into break here. When we come back, we're going to actually do Flat Earth 101 with ODD and talk a little bit about this just amazing subject.
Yeah.
Stay tuned. Welcome back. Segment two of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com. Your protection from deception all across America, all around the world. The number to call in is 866-37-TRUTH. Again, 866-378-7884. I want to welcome everybody who is in the chat room. I've got a big crowd in there today. Irish Pete, Lucky, Two Feathers, my wife Beth, Brendan O'Shea, Charles Calvo, Charlie Gordon, Daryl Bowles, Jim Dale, Lewis Taw, Melissa Taylor, Molly Gordon, Redempti, Stacy, Thomas Silk, and Zella Zapitsky. Always a pleasure and an honor to have you join us here in the chat room. In fact, the chat room is probably the best as far as live radio goes on the internet. You can always join us here. If you're on the Listen Live tab, just hit the chat room tab and pop over. You can sign in with Twitter or you can sign in with Facebook. My guest today is ODD. And again, he doesn't need much of an introduction to anybody in the truth movement. He's been around for quite some time. His research, his videos, certainly about flat. I mean, he's top tier, just pure and simple. He's top tier. And it's great to have him on the show. ODD, before we get into Flat Earth 101, for those of out there listening who may not be real familiar with this yet, I want to address something that is in the chat room right now. There are many people out there, in fact, just recently, because some of my artwork on my show on YouTube, I actually show a globe, but right next to it is my very subtle Flat Earth logo. I don't know if you've seen my new logo, but it's superimposed. The azimuth equidistant map is superimposed over my logo. But I also have a globe on my deal, and I was being called a shill and a gatekeeper and all kinds of derogatory things. And that seems to be happening a lot, especially from flat earthers. And there are some people saying in the chat room that if you don't believe in flat earth or even just kind of exploring it, but there are people that attack you and call you dumb and stupid if you believe in a globe. you know, it's turning some people off. I mean, are those the PSYOP trolls that are doing this? Because I know you, myself, Rob Skiba, Zen Garcia, we don't act that way. We know how difficult it is to unprogram from this indoctrination. So, I mean, do you believe there is a PSYOP troll agenda within the Flat Earth movement?
Absolutely. It's just too big of a thing for there not to be. I mean, they have trolls for much smaller situations where conspiracy is involved. So for the Flat Earth to be coming out and picking up so much steam, I guarantee a lot of people are being paid, and they're called paid government trolls, PGTs. And the CIA has already, you know, come out with documents proving that they've been doing this for a long time. So I know there's that, but also in every group of people on Earth, there are the assholes, you know. I know people that are, they're passionate about the Flat Earth, but they always come up there. If somebody believes in the globe, they just get all, you're a globe head. And I'm like, oh man, you're going to turn them off to that stuff. And that's how I feel too. But you know, there's so many angles for it. There's good-hearted people accidentally driving people away, and there's guaranteed there's paid trolls, you know, doing this on purpose. But
best advice is for people not to engage those type of people. In fact, you know, John Pounders and I were talking about this the other day, and how sometimes I just start, I just go red at some of the comments, and I have learned to just ignore it. In fact, what I usually tell somebody is, your supercilious and unmindful attitude is exactly what's wrong with the world today. And if you don't know what supercilious and unmindful means, it means you're an arrogant jerk. But it's a nice way of telling them that. So that's usually what I say.
Yeah. And what you were saying about your logo and all that, man, I mean, the people have the right to be paranoid, especially with all this stuff that's coming out. But I just got to implore people to listen to the person and their information and don't go off of some of the materialistic things you're seeing, like logos or something like that, because, you know, we're all actually trapped here in this Luciferian construct, and you pretty much can't go one day or even an hour without interacting or utilizing something within this Luciferian construct, whether it's knowing or unknowing. So, you know, people are making videos about me being a Freemason because I was on a video, and just for half a second, I clasped my, my two index fingers together with my thumbs and made the triangle. And it was, I swear, it was just for a split second. And yeah, now I'm a Freemason, and there's a bunch of videos about it. It's absolutely, it's funny, but it's also, it's not good for this movement to have everyone be a shill just because you disagree, don't like them, or you see something that may be a little questionable. Like I'm saying, we are trapped in this Luciferian construct, and we're all guilty of doing these things knowingly and unknowingly.
Yeah, absolutely, consciously and unconsciously, because we are in a spiritual, supernatural battle. You've got a new album coming out. We're going to play a clip from that new album. This song is the new album, ODD, what is the new album going to be called?
Never Sleep Again.
They live, they, what is it? They live, we sleep.
Never Sleep Again is, I'm a big movie buff, and you know, I grew up watching a lot of this, A Nightmare on Elm Street, where the theme song for Freddy Krueger is 9, 10, never sleep again. And, my whole thing is, you know, it's kind of just a shot at, you know, us being awake, and this music is for the people that have been awakened. So never sleep again. Once you wake up, you can't really go back. It's not as easy as just, I'm going to, you know, can I find a blue pill now? It's not going to work like that.
Yeah. You know, in fact, the other day, ODD, I was like, man, sometimes I wish I could stick my head back in the ground, but it's simply not an option for me. There's a lot of things that aren't options for me, and that is one of them. I can't stick my head back in the ground. And just so you know, many people out there, this is a Christian show, but you know what? Every now and then it's okay to use a curse word, and especially within music. And I think you use them well-timed, ODD. And I like the new song. Are you busting an 808 there? Is that where the bass is coming from?
Yeah, basically. I got the most basic kind of sub bass for that, and that would be an 808. So.
Yeah, that's the good stuff, man. I got an 808. I bought a little drum kit for Liam. So let's bust into, we're going to play some more music in a little while, but let's bust into Flat Earth 101. For somebody who has not really approached this yet, for somebody who is starting to go, wait a minute, this is crazy. You guys are nuts. What are some of the first things they need to look at to start wrapping their head around the fact that we have been deceived?
Okay, a very important thing that I like to share for newcomers and first timers is, all right, let's look at the pictures of the Earth. Okay. Are there any real pictures of the Earth? You got to ask these guys that, and they're going to report, well, yeah, you know, they think, and just like I thought and you thought, that those pictures they were showing us, we always thought those were real until we actually investigated. So I like to get them on the path, or even in my videos, I like to show right away that these people that work for NASA and make these artist renditions, they come out and say that it is photoshopped, because it has to be. So that's one of the biggest first things I like to get them on, because it's like, you know, it makes you go, well, why don't we have any pictures of the Earth? So,
you know, and again, actually talking about Kyrie Irving earlier, and the fact that Neil deGrasse Tyson, our friend, Neil deGrasse Tyson responded to him about what he was saying there. He actually said, you know, if he wants to think the Earth is flat, go right ahead, as long as he continues to play basketball and not become head of any space agencies. My point is, if you have certain limitations of understanding of the natural world, stay away from jobs that require that. And I think it's important for people to understand, and I know you know this, and many people don't realize this, is that we've been shown many, many pictures. They're all computer generated. They actually admit they cannot get high enough to take a picture of the planet, which we're going to talk about that here in a little while. But I also want to point out what Neil deGrasse Tyson says. Now, this guy, you know, him and Bill Nye and whatnot are all, they're just on board with the whole deception. But this is Neil deGrasse Tyson talking about the shape of the planet.
So it's not actually a sphere. It's oblate. And officially it's an oblate spheroid. That's what we call it. But not only that, it's slightly wider below the equator than above the equator.
A little chubbier.
Yeah. Chubby's a good way. It's like pear-shaped.
Yeah.
So it turns out the pear-shapedness is bigger than the height of Mount Everest above sea level.
Now, ODD, I think your point is well taken here, because the pictures that we do have of the alleged planet, the spinning ball in space, if you look at them on your computer and you do any type of photo editing software, they are a perfect sphere to the pixel. But now we have Neil deGrasse Tyson coming out and saying, well, it's really an oblate spheroid. So, you know, are the pictures are lies? Yes.
Yes, absolutely. And you set me up exactly what I was going to go into next. When I get into the pictures, I'd like to get right into the fact that all the pictures were presented by NASA, are perfectly round, perfectly spherical. And then Neil says that about it being pear-shaped, while the Earth is officially classified as an oblate spheroid, which if you look that up, it's slightly flattened at the poles, and it looks nothing like what we're shown in the pictures. And that's my next point, to prove that you know, that the pictures are fake. And then I immediately move into the shape of the continents, how they're all, they're always different sizes in each picture.
And even our maps, our mapping systems, all the continents seem to change sizes. In fact, the United States is often pictured much larger on a map when really it is quite small.
Yeah, there's that. There's so many different errors that we could point out with their maps. I mean, and all it's going to boil down to for someone that believes in the globe is, oh, well, they can't accurately portray a globe on a flat piece of paper. While that's true, we should be able to have maps with the continents that are the relative size. Like they come out and admit, if you look hard enough, you'll find that Greenland on the maps, that the basic map that's in schools, is much, much bigger on the map. But in real life, it's, you know, it's way smaller, and many more errors like that with all the continents. And if you read the fine print in the corner, it tells you this is actually bigger than that. This is actually further away from there. And nobody reads that fine print, but it's all there. And it's like, you know, we should at least have the relative sizes. And that's they don't even give us that on the maps.
Right. So as we move past the pictures, obviously the computer-generated NASA photo ops, even coming from the moon. We're going to talk about the moon landing in the next hour because I've got some questions for you regarding that. But what's the next thing? Once people wrap their head around the fact that we really don't have any pictures of the planet from space, the only two are in existence is the same picture flipped over. Okay, so let's get past that. What's the next thing that they should look at?
There's a lot of ways to go, but personally, my favorite proof for the flat Earth is water, the physics of water and how it's to find its level and maintain its level if it's not being manipulated by wind or currents or tides, which also do not prove a globe Earth. But we could get into that in a little while, too. But if the water, any water, body of water, it only conforms to the container that it's in. And the water on Earth is flat, and it's contained within most likely the ice walls. I'm big on the map as it, the flat Earth map as we have it from Gleason's. I believe in that map, and I believe that the water is being held in and it's conforming to the shape of the container, and yeah, being held in by the ice wall. So study the flatness of water, look into how water does not curve. Okay. There's no experiments that prove it. And then that kind of ties into looking into distances and where we should see curve when we're looking at objects in the distance. And those two things are important, I think, to start with.
Yeah, the song that we played at the top of the show mentions that. You know, why is water always flat when unmanipulated? There's another line in that song that we played at the top of the show, too. Gravity is our imaginary magic friend, and I love that line. And I think gravity is one of the things that people need to look at, too. I mean, is gravity just a bunch of BS?
Yeah, and that's one of the first things that you'll hear from somebody who believes in the globe is, well, haven't you heard of gravity? And then you got to get them to understand that gravity is and always has been nothing more than a theory, yet it's now somehow fact. It's just a fact, you know, in a lot of people's minds. But if you get them to look and go back and start fact-checking, even it says the theory of gravity, it always starts with something like that. So it is a theory, but
It is a continuing theory. In fact, it's never been proven. But you know what I found really interesting, ODD, is most recently, just about 6 months ago, maybe 7 months ago, NASA came out, another rocket scientist and physicist said, oh, we have now actually measured gravitational waves, which thus proving the theory of gravity. I found the timing very interesting when Flat Earth really started to blow up and people really started asking questions. And next thing you know, here comes NASA saying, oh, yeah, we've discovered gravitational waves and we can measure them.
Yeah, it's complete BS, and they just show us another animation. Like every time they try to prove something, they just have an animation.
Mm-hmm. You know what? I've got my own theories as to what really goes on, and we talked about at the top of the hour. We talked about the firmament, and obviously we know that Tesla was supplanted, and all of his research and all of his theories and everything that he came to believe was based on the electric universe and the fact that we had a plasma sky. It isn't a vacuum. It's all plasma, which kind of goes in with the crystalline type of dome idea. Have you explored any of that and looking at Tesla and what his thoughts were with the plasma sky?
Not really, but it is interesting. I've looked into it a little bit, and I do understand Tesla more now. The flat Earth makes it almost the things Tesla were doing, and when you start looking at electromagnetic universe and stuff like that, Tesla, it becomes apparent that he was really tapping into the energies that are natural, you know, on this flat Earth. And some of the stuff is most likely caused by the dome, the crystalline heavens.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And I want to invite everybody, if you guys got questions about flat Earth, we got ODD here on air. If you got questions, feel free to call in and we can talk about this, because I know a lot of people out there are scratching their head going, oh my goodness, these guys are crazy. The number to call in is 866-37-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-378-7884. Just join us on air. And if you got some questions or comments about flat Earth, feel free to join us as well. It's funny, I'm looking here. Somebody just posted in the chat room a picture of Neil Armstrong's moon landing suits, and it actually shows the soles. And then right next to it is the picture of the footprint on the moon, which looks nothing like the soles of the astronaut suit that is actually preserved in a museum. That's funny.
Yeah, that's great stuff. And that's something that Kyrie Irving, I believe, I've been watching some of the videos that he's been talking in. And I think he said that the moon print doesn't match. He was telling the media that when they were interviewing him.
And also, actually, you know, if you guys have a question, you don't want to call in on air, feel free to join us in the chat room as well. And I will try to monitor that also. Yeah. And Kyrie's talking about the moon landing hoax too. You know, again, your point at the top of the show is well taken. You know, is this part of the PSYOP to make us all look just wacko, you know, tinfoil hat wearing?
Yeah, at the end of the day, I'm always happy that, you know, if we're getting attention to the flat Earth. So I can't say that it's a PSYOP that he was put out there. It'd be, you know, none of us know. But if it is, they're not doing a very good job. And more people are waking up to the flat Earth. So the only question I have is it being, you know, released on purpose? I'm not sure if they're trying to co-opt the movement, but they're going to have to, you know, the elite are going to get desperate and have to try something, because it is getting too big. They're going to be like, all right, well, there's nothing we can do about this transforming over to the main, you know, a mainstream belief. So let's take it the reins, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. There's a question in the chat room here. Why can't I see Polaris from Australia, the North Pole star Polaris? How do we explain that on a flat Earth map?
Well, the flat Earth, you know, it's not. When you're on a ball, it kind of gets, I guess I can't say it's smaller, but it is a flat plane. If you were to rip that ball open and flatten it out, it would be a much bigger surface area. And in this case of not being able to see Polaris, well, that's because it's not as far as they tell us. It's fixed right above the North Pole. And the further you get away from it, the more perspective still applies the further you get, the more it goes down. So it's the same case with the sun. When it's coming from the east and it's appearing to set in the west, it's just getting further away from you and only appearing to go down. So on a vast flat surface, there are points where Polaris would be under the horizon due only to perspective.
You know, I find it interesting when you come to the perspective topic. And then obviously we look at chemtrails and geoengineering and these just huge lines being sprayed all over the sky. When I started looking at flat Earth and I started looking at chemtrails, oftentimes these things look like a missile went straight up in the air, because as it goes down in the distance, but the plane has not changed altitude. But as it moves further away from you, it will appear to lower on the horizon. That is what we're talking about when we're talking about perspective, right?
Yes, absolutely. I'm glad you brought that up. I mean, a lot of people don't get it, but if you were just to go type in on Google a perspective matrix, it'll give you a kind of grid of how we see. And excuse me, everything in the sky or up above you appears to slant, cave. It just kind of slants down, while what's under you slants up. And that's where the horizon line, vanishing point, is where those two things meet. You cannot see you cannot see past that. And that is just your vision. That doesn't mean that on a flat Earth you would be able to see infinitely, because that perspective still applies.
Absolutely. And again, if you, for people with that question and the question from the chat room about Polaris, just Google the perspective matrix. And this is how perspective works. You have that vanishing line of your visible horizon. You have divergent and convergent. So if something moves away from you, it will appear to drop in altitude, but it really is not. In many cases, and I think chemtrails obviously illustrate that very, very well. When we come back, we're going to talk more about flat Earth. I want to talk about the moon landings. I also want to talk about gravity. We're going to talk about NASA. And one of the big things I want to talk about are these alleged speeds that somehow they have determined that the Earth is moving, that it's moving around the sun, and that the whole solar system is moving, that the galaxy is moving. I want to talk about that too, because you do a very good job of explaining that in some of your videos. And again, you can go check out ODD or Odd Reality on YouTube. Definitely check out ODD's channel. So when we come back, we got a lot more coming. The Awakening Liberty Show with my guest, ODD, and we're going to play some more music too, because I think his stuff just bumps, man. It's certainly fly. So everybody stay tuned. The Awakening Liberty Show is going to be right back.
Tuned into the Truth Frequency.
We are TFR. TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Hi, everyone. This is Sean from the Awakening Liberty Show. Are you and your family prepared for an emergency? Have you ever thought about investing in food and water storage? Well, if you have, I urge you to check out my one-stop prepper shop. AwakeningLibertyStore.com carries the full line of Legacy Premium, non-GMO, made-in-USA emergency food storage and survival gear. Folks, I've tried them all, and Legacy Premium is the best I've found. Boasting the lowest cost per pound, the lowest cost per calorie, and the largest serving size in the industry, Legacy Premium is simply the best. Not to mention it was voted best tasting in blind taste tests, and I personally concur. Shop AwakeningLibertyStore.com and use coupon code PATRIOT for a special listener discount, or call me personally at 775-276-4046. Once again, AwakeningLibertyStore.com. And we are back. Hour number two of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com. Always a pleasure and honor to be back behind the microphone, as I do every Saturday and Sunday at 2 p.m. Pacific time. I want to mention that this segment of the Awakening Liberty Show is being brought to you by dcwebdesigns.net and Future Dan over at futuredanger.com. Again, I want to welcome everybody in the chat room. My guest today is ODD. And again, he doesn't need much of an introduction to the people who are talking about prominence in the Truth Movement. ODD is top tier. And we're going to get into some more of this Flat Earth 101. There's some more questions from the chat room. And again, if you would like to call in and talk about this and maybe ask some questions, or, you know, do you agree? Do you think it's flat? Do you think it's a sphere? I mean, let's talk about this a little bit. So the number to call in is 866-37-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-378-7884. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. And I want to mention that if you are going to go down this flat earth rabbit hole, start looking at the Bible, number one, for some of the evidence, because it does tell us that the earth is actually flat and stationary. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that today. But get into what is going on also with Genesis 6. Start to understand that we are, as ODD so aptly put, in a battle, a Luciferian matrix. Once you wrap your head around that too, then you can start to wrap your head around so many of the world events. And it makes much more sense that they are, in fact, trying to separate us and our specialness from God. On the phone from Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, we got Robbie Davidson joining us. Robbie, how are you doing today?
Doing good, Sean. Thanks for taking my call. Hey, ODD, it's good to hear you on the show.
Hey, man. Thanks a lot. Nice to have you, too.
Yeah, man. It's going to be great when we all get together in Raleigh, North Carolina in November. Man, I'm really looking forward to it. Tell us a little bit about the conference, Robbie.
A little bit about the conference. It's a Flat Earth International Conference. It will be hosted in Raleigh, North Carolina, November 9th and 10th of this year. And we're really excited. We've got just an all-star lineup. We've got Rob Skiba. We've got ODD, Patricia Steer, Mark Sargent, Jaron Campanella from Jaronism, Bob Nodell from Globusters. We got John Christopoulos from the Morgal. It's known now. Brian Mullen, myself, Emmanuel Lakonga, the Controversy 7. Mr. Thrive and Survive, and we've got Amy Denise from Simply Seeking Truth, and Carly Madrano. So it's going to be an amazing time. We've got a lot of amazing stuff planned, and right after the kickoff, Brian and I, the first session is ODD, taking us off with Flat Earth 101, and it's just going to be absolutely incredible. No talking with ODD is already starting to prepare, so it's going to be serious, and hopefully everyone is going to be excited as we are.
ODD, are you going to kick it off with some music, brother?
That's definitely a possibility.
Yeah, with your performance skills, man, you should probably go up there and rap the whole Flat Earth 101. I think that would be cool. So November 9th and 10th, 2017, where can everybody go to check out the Flat Earth International Conference webpage?
Yeah, it's really easy. Just go to fe2017.com. Just F. E as in Flat Earth, but fe2017.com. And you'll be able to check everything out from everyone that's going to be there, the schedule, information on exhibitors or sponsors. Also, we have our free app for Android and Apple, which has been phenomenal. There's been so many people joining, and there's an entire community and social media kind of features on the app. So we're really excited, and we just want to keep building the momentum. Like I said, the response has been absolutely phenomenal. We're so happy just with the support and just how everyone's coming together just to see that this is so important to get this truth out there. And we're just coming together collectively with all our different talents and skills and just what we bring. And we're just really excited, for the future for sure.
Absolutely. Now, how can, I guess on the website at fe2017.com, people can actually sign up as a sponsor. And I'd like to let everybody know that the Awakening Liberty Show is going to be a proud sponsor of the Flat Earth International Conference. And how can people, are people, you know, if they got businesses and stuff like that, they can actually go and have some exhibits and stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to have like exhibitor tables, like booths as well. And there have been quite a few people showing definite interest and even signing up. And we're going to have some really cool stuff on display. We wanted to make sure that we had some really neat stuff for people that are there, just different concepts, models, some surprises. And like I said, there's certain things that we're not even announcing just to make it just more special than even people think it is. So we've got a lot of amazing things in store. And just check it out. You can find all the information on fe2017.com. And hope to see you all out there.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. And again, Robbie, let everybody know about your YouTube channel and Celebrate Truth.
Sure. Yeah, my channel is Celebrate Truth. So you can go to YouTube and just type in Celebrate Truth, and got almost 200 videos now. And I've come up with a couple documentaries, and my latest one is Scientism Exposed. And that one you can definitely check out for free on YouTube. And if you want to buy the DVD, I know that ODD actually bought a DVD. So thank you so much again for just your support. And it's just awesome. I'm so so excited just with what's going on. People using it as a tool to get that truth out there. Like I said, into libraries and schools. And I mean, people are doing it so many different ways. And just the approach of Scientism Exposed, like I said, it's not so much in your face, but it just starts getting those questions. People start questioning things, then they start doing their search. So I just think it's really exciting because a lot of people are on that quest for truth, and hopefully they can come across the great information. And obviously, when it comes down to what my heart's all about, is obviously I want to be able to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus with people, because like he said, he's the way, the truth, and the life. So I always say, hey man, examine Jesus, and like, either he is who he said he is, or he's not. And that's really as simple as it gets. And that's what kind of got me on my path, 20 years ago, was pretty much looking into the truth of who this man is that claimed to be the truth. I mean, either he's a lunatic, he's a liar, or his Lord. And yeah, I did my investigation and obviously came to the conclusion that he is who he said he is. And it definitely changed my life. And it's been an amazing journey. Everything that he's been taking me down and getting into this now with creation is just absolutely amazing. And it's amazing to see so many people, you know, turning to the Bible, just turning to really be hungry for the truth. And I think that God is working with people all around the world right now, just hungry for the truth. And God is revealing his truth in amazing ways. So it's really encouraging.
And absolutely. And ODD, you are a brother indeed, but you know, you may be a brother in Christ here soon. What you were saying in the first hour was actually giving me chills, brother.
I got to say, watching people like Robbie and Rob Skiba, and I have a buddy named Nathan Thompson. He's actually, he has one of the most popular Flat Earth groups on Facebook. It's called Flat Earth Globe Earth Discussions. And I was he stopped by through my town, wanted to hang out. So I got with him and he told me, you know, Jesus is basically giving you a free gift. You know, why would you not take it? You know, and he makes me think, and I, you know, this stuff is serious, man. I take Genesis from the Bible 100% literal. And if I do that, I have to be willing to take more steps into this stuff. So thank you guys for the encouragement.
Much love to you, ODD. Thank you so much, Robbie, for joining us today and talking about the Flat Earth International Conference. Again, Raleigh, North Carolina, November 9th and 10th, 2017. Go to fe2017.com. Book your reservations. Get your hotel rooms. It's going to be a heck of a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to it. In fact, ODD, man, I think I'll bring my guitar. Maybe we'll bust out some stuff.
Absolutely, man.
Robbie, you have a great day, okay?
You too, guys. Blessings to you guys. And I look forward to the rest of the show. Take care.
Later, brother.
Later, man. And we do have one other caller here. We're going to take a quick call from Victorville, California, USA. Before we actually proceed here, again, area code 760, Victorville, California. You are live on the Awakening Liberty Show. How are you doing today?
Yeah. About 2 years ago, I didn't really have an online life. I'm more of a country boy. And I got online for another reason, and I found out about this Flat Earth movement. I was brought up on Flat Earth. And so when I put out this other idea about over a year ago, year and a half ago, that Earth is a time toroid, and I haven't been able to get any comments on it. I've got lots of people going to my website, but no comments on it.
And what did you say your theory was?
A time toroid.
Have you heard that theory at all, ODD?
Well, not really, but if I'm guessing correctly, what he's talking about with the toroid, Bob from Globusters has kind of speculated on that a little bit and could make a little bit of sense of it with the electromagnetic stance situation versus no gravity, you know.
Right. And, you know, Revising Reality, I would encourage you, caller, to check out Revising Reality and Anthony Patch, because he talks about CERN and the fact that it is a toroid, and it's all based off of Tesla technology, which really makes a lot of sense when you start looking at Flat Earth. And so check out Revising Reality. In fact, you too, ODD, yeah. If you haven't read that book, it's actually from a Christian perspective, looking at physics and looking at Genesis 6 and looking at CERN and looking at the Luciferian agenda. I highly recommend it. It's super good stuff.
I'm on it.
Well, if you have a chance, check out my time. Earth is a time toroid. It's a dish-shaped Earth, but it's a toroid. I don't know. You'll have to check it out.
Yeah,
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we'll take a look at that. Absolutely. And thanks for calling in and sharing that with us today, for sure. ODD, I want to get into these absurdities from NASA. Okay. First of all, they tell us, and I want you to break this down because you probably got all the figures in your head. I always seem to forget them, about the speeds that we are traveling through space. Can you explain that a little bit? Because I think people who are looking at Flat Earth need to understand the absurdities behind that. And in fact, why on earth if these speeds are accurate, why the stars have never changed position in all of navigational history. The North Star has always been in the same place. Talk a little bit about the speed of the planet, the solar system, and the galaxy, and obviously the sun.
I'm very glad you brought it up, because that's another one of my go-tos for 101. And what we have is, we're being told that the Earth is spinning at 1,040 miles per hour. That's the official figure, 1,040 miles per hour. And we, you know, we spin. But meanwhile, we're also going, we're traveling around the sun on our Earth, going 66,000 miles per hour, they say. But not only that, we're traveling around the sun, spinning, and the entire solar system, using the sun as the center, is shooting off through outer space at about 490,000 miles per hour, which is, it's just like, okay, you know, and, but it doesn't stop there. They keep going, and they say the solar system within the Milky Way galaxy itself, the Milky Way galaxy is also going its own speed of over 1 million miles per hour throughout infinite space, with all the rest of the galaxies flying around the same way. So the first thing that is messed up about all this is that the simple rotation of the Earth itself has never been detected. There's never been an experiment to prove that the Earth spins. And yet we have all these other ridiculous speeds that we're going, and they can't tell us why they know that, or they, and they also don't have any evidence or documentation to show that they did experiments to prove these things. And the experiments that they did do for the Earth spin were, would be things like the Michelson-Morley experiment. Actually, they were testing the Earth's speed around the sun. So that's the second speed, not the Earth's spin. But they were testing for the Earth's rotation around the sun. The results were no detection of movement.
Yeah, and, you know, I got to tell you, you know, when I get in a car, I'm very sensitive to movement and speed. And it's funny, the guy they're calling from Victorville, I remember Victorville very well, driving race cars down there, country boys. But, you know, when I'm moving, I can feel it. And I don't sense any movement as I walk around. Obviously, you know, your people who don't believe in flat earth are going to say, well, it's so huge, it would be irrelevant. But, you know, I would think if we were moving 1,000 miles an hour, we would have something going on. We would feel something. And then again, if we're talking about like the gravitron, if we're spinning on a ball, just like water on a basketball, if you spin it on your finger, that water is going to go flying off. So is that gravity, you know, or is that the Tesla idea of the plasma dome or buoyancy?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's just, when it comes to gravity, you just look at it like this, like, we got, they're saying it's holding over 3 trillion gallons of water to the Earth as the Earth spins, moves, flies, darts through outer space in all sorts of different varying speeds. And the water is stuck to the Earth. And as a whole, water weighs a lot. So like, if you were taking the water all, weighing it all at once, that is being held to the Earth just fine and being formed into a ball shape. Yet little tiny bugs, birds, and even, I mean, stuff like that could take off and fly and defy gravity. And it, stuff like that doesn't make sense, you know?
Well, yeah. And if gravity is so powerful actually to hold the oceans in place, why are we not being crushed?
Yeah.
That's it's crazy. Absolutely. So once we get past that, because when I started looking at that too, I'm going, wait, these speeds don't make any sense. If we're hurtling through the universe, at these speeds, you know, why aren't things moving? But then we go back to the biblical and the scriptural guidelines that state that the heaven, the earth, everything rotates around us. The next thing that I always found very interesting was when people started talking about flat earth theory. And I want to talk a little bit about the flat earth model here. People need to wrap their heads around the distances to the sun and the moon. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, you know, when people look into the flat earth stuff and we're talking about the sun, moon, and stars, they automatically think that all that stuff is still in the same place as science says it is, which it is not. Pretty much everything changes. The sun is much closer. I don't really like to speculate on what the distances is, but some people say it's like around 3,000 miles. I happen to think it's much closer than that. And it also is smaller. So some people speculated that it's 32 miles across, something like that. And it could be even smaller than that if it's closer still. And I do believe that it's closer. And the moon is much closer. I mean, you could just see these things so perfect, you know, and they tell us stars are billions of miles away. And we're seeing stars from years ago, even decades ago. They're just barely getting to us. Or it's all nonsense. All this stuff is right here, right in front of us. It's right above us, very close. And if you start experimenting with your telescopes, cameras, Nikon P900s, it becomes very clear that all this stuff within the firmament, stars, sun and moon, it's all here. It's all really close. And it's not what the mainstream science says it is at all.
Right. There's a question in the chat room about Foucault's pendulum. Does that not prove Earth's rotation?
Absolutely not. The Foucault pendulum has to be manually started by a human being in order to go. And not only that, if the Foucault pendulum proved the movement of the Earth, there would not be one pendulum on Earth that would be still.
That's interesting. Most definitely. Let's talk a little bit more about Flat Earth 101. Where's the next place that somebody should go if they're really looking into this?
Let's go to, I would take people to the old books. There's a lot of Flat Earth people writing books all the way up into the early 1900s. And that says a lot. It says a lot because you got all these people writing these huge books full of facts and even stating why all the other scientists and whatnot are wrong, going all the way back to Galileo and whatnot. They're, you know, debunking them and making these books all the way into the early 1900s. And so I really like to let people know that. And I show people the Samuel Rowbotham books. There's a guy named David Wardlaw Scott, William Carpenter, and these guys wrote some decent books and even made their they have visual models that you could look at, and they always match up to pretty much the Gleason's map model of the flat Earth. And I'm pretty big time proponent of it because a lot of stuff proves the Gleason's. But people all the way up into the early 1900s, flat earthers. I mean, that says a lot. So I like to point people to those guys.
Yeah. Again, up until 500 years ago, everybody knew the earth was flat. In fact, they thought they were going to fall off the edge, and that became a myth. That was the fear factor of actually going out into the ocean and falling off the edge. But in fact, the flat earth model itself is not, there is no edge. There's a wall in Antarctica, correct? And again, you mentioning the map, the Gleason map, and I always came back to the reference of the UN map. Antarctica does not exist on the UN map. In fact, it is an azimuth equidistant map, and Antarctica is being depicted by the wreath around the other continents, which I found very, very interesting. Why is the UN using a flat earth map?
That's a good question. I mean, it's highly symbolic for me when I see that. So it's obvious, you know, these guys are the Illuminati think tank of the world. So they're definitely probably going to be putting symbolism like that in plain sight. And not to mention, it has the 33 rungs or, you know, like centerpieces that you could, that in the grid, you count 33 pieces, and all of it just, it's screaming truth in plain sight to me.
It's screaming that 33rd degree Freemasonry and the secret societies and all that stuff. Another question from the chat room. What is your opinion of Admiral E. Byrd, the TV interview? I believe it was on Chronoscope, Longines Chronoscope or something like that. What is your take on Admiral Byrd?
I believe that it's possible that he may have led one of the very first voyages to the Antarctic continent. And I have seen him on, because the place is unbearable. Now, I don't think ancient people were going there. And I do believe we live in the snow globe kind of model of the earth. And when people were trying to go to, nobody was trying to go to Antarctica, it was unbearable. So when we finally, you know, got people doing it, we got Admiral Byrd doing it. And he went there for he led Operation High Jump. Now, high jump means that they jumped high to get onto the Antarctic ice walls so they could investigate and start basically making bases permanent bases in Antarctica, and they kept on doing these missions all throughout the late 30s, 40s, and even 50s. They were doing all these missions to Antarctica, setting up these bases. Admiral Byrd said something strange on his interview. He said that if, you know, they went to Antarctica, and when they got, he said, on the other side, they found a unused, untapped into continent. I forgot what size he said it was. I think South America, the size of South America.
Yeah, he said it was as big as North America, absolutely. And it was full of resources, and it was green. It wasn't ice.
Right, right. So that gives credence to the more land idea. And I'm not against it, but more land or not, I'm definitely not an infinite plane theorist. I believe that somewhere it ends with the dome coming down and meeting the ground, like kind of like in the model that we look at, you know?
Mm-hmm. And if you're looking into flat Earth, folks, definitely start with everything that ODD has talked about, but also look at Richard Byrd. And he talked about Operation High Jump was obviously to try to get above this wall. And he had an entire naval armada down there. They ran into some difficulties and they aborted the mission. And it was followed by an operation called Operation Fishbowl, which I found very, very odd, just to name it that, which were a series of high altitude tests with nuclear weapons. And if you start connecting dots here, what were they trying to do? Did they find the dome? Did they find the edge? Did they find the firmament? Were they trying to break through? I find that very, very interesting. Real quick here, we're going to go into break here pretty quick, but we have area code 509, Colville, Washington. You are live on the Awakening Liberty Show. How are you doing today?
Hello, how are you?
Good.
I would just like to do a shout out thank you to Rob Skiba, Vin Garcia, and Odd TV, ODD.
Thank you.
About 2 years ago, I started studying my Bible again.
Was it because of Flat Earth?
No. I started in Genesis, and I became a Flat Earth believer because of Genesis 1. Then I found you guys. And thank God. I felt so alone before I found you all. Thank you so much, all of you.
God bless you. Know that you are never alone. Absolutely. God is always with you. Jesus Christ is always with you. Praise God that you were able to come back to it. And we are there for you. We'll always be there for you because we're just truth seekers, just like you are. And as the Bible tells us, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. And that's such a beautiful thing. And I think that is what's going on in the world. We're going to be right back. Thank you, caller. Awakening Liberty Show with my guest, ODD. We'll be right back.
Listening to the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
No hate, no hype, no fear.
I'll bust it one time. Truth and liberty. Fighting the world order and the tyranny. The Awakening Liberty Show is Sean Caron.
And welcome back. The final segment of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com, your protection from deception. Real quick, I want to mention the awakeninglibertyshow.com website, awakeninglibertyshow.com. And I got some great guests scheduled. Stop by, check out the calendar and a couple of things. You can also get the Awakening Liberty store there. And also my wife, Beth, she's running our health and wellness division. And we are proud and honored to be carrying Youngevity products. So stop by there. Just go right to the website. You'll see the Youngevity 90 for Life. I take Tangy Tangerine every day. EFA, we just ordered some of our colloidal silver. It's making us feel a heck of a lot better. We're getting out of that whole pharma culture because there are so many ways to heal yourselves. In fact, your body can perpetually heal yourself if you're getting the right nutrition. Again, Awakening Wellness. You can go to awakeninglibertyshow.com and directly link to our Awakening Wellness site. Much love to you all. Also, today we got ODD here going, and this is just a great show. And I want to thank the caller who called in before the break there. You know, that's a heart-wrenching. And I'm hearing so much of that. People who were agnostics, they were atheists, they were not in touch with God, they were not in tune with our Creator, and they're coming back to God, especially when they start finding flat Earth. They start actually realizing 9/11 was an inside job, that so many of the world events were perpetrated. They have been made to happen. They weren't by accident. And I think it's a hugely important that people start to understand and connect these dots. Because once you do, you're going to go down a rabbit hole. And every time I get to what I think is the bottom, there's a left or right turn. It is very difficult, and sometimes it's very difficult to wake up to this. Wouldn't you agree, ODD?
Yeah, absolutely. There's definitely not there, you know, we're not alone once you realize that there's this whole community of people online and even getting together offline nowadays, like I do with a lot of the people. But we're definitely not alone anymore. So trust that.
Yeah, definitely. You're up in the Pac Northwest, right?
Yeah, I'm in Colorado, Southwest. Oh. I don't know. You're Southwest.
Yeah, for some reason I thought you were up in the Northwest, in the Pacific Northwest. You're not too far from us. You're just a state away. We got to get together here soon, man. And of course, we're going to see each other in November, but that's going to be awesome. There's a question in the chat room that's getting some debate in here. And this was a question that I had an issue with. And it has to deal with, and until you understand the flat Earth model, and we're going to talk about that here in a little bit. But the question is, how can you see the sun and the moon in the sky at the same time? And some people are saying, oh, that's a dumb question. Well, actually, it's not a dumb question because it was something I had to wrap my head around when I was looking at the flat Earth model. What did you, where did your theories and your answers come from that?
Well, I mostly got it just by doing the studies, research, and looking at it myself, because you could listen to all these people and even me, and I don't expect anybody to just flat out believe me or trust me, but everybody has, they present a lot of their own thoughts on the matter. And my thoughts on the matter are that, while it's more than possible with the size of the level plane that we live on and the size and distance, the closer distance of the sun and moon. Yeah. It's very possible to have them at the same time without having to light up the entire flat surface. If you would look at the model, just type in flat Earth models or model, and you'll probably find some videos and you could get a rough idea of what it looks like. But the entire surface doesn't have to be lit up just because the sun is always above it. It's smaller, closer, and it spotlights the area that it's over. But
and it creates hot spots. There's millions of pictures of hot spots of the sun. If it was 95 million miles away, you're not going to get a hot spot. And you can do a simple test with that with just a light bulb. I think that's really important when you start to understand is maybe the sun is a heck of a lot closer than they're telling us. And in fact, biblically, it tells us it's inside the firmament. OK, so it's inside the dome. So if the dome is 3,000 miles high or whatever, I don't even know if we know yet. I bet you there are some elite that know. But at the same time, it is within the firmament and they're telling us that. The other thing. So people understand the flat Earth model. This is the best way I can describe it on the radio without showing you. Take a compact disc or a DVD and lay it down flat. Okay. Now, the center of that compact disc is the North Pole. Now, you don't have the sun going around a globe. You've got the sun moving around in a circle. So, and because it's close, it's actually lighting up those areas, which causes the time zone effect. And as it moves, the moon is also there. But here was my question, and this is what I started to look at, ODD, was when I looked at the model, because people asked the question about the seasons. Is it, in your opinion, and in many models, is the fact that there is a tightening and widening spiral of the moon and the sun going around the flat plane, is that how you see it?
Yes, and that's explained quite simply at the bottom of the Gleason's map. And that's another thing. A lot of people don't think it's a flat earth map, but the creator of the map was in fact a flat earther. And on the bottom, it tells you about seasons. And when the sun is in the Tropic of Cancer, Capricorn, it's kind of fluctuating between the two and spiraling from tighter to wider circles, causing seasons. And it makes so much sense when you think about it that way.
And I've heard other people say that not only is it just a concentric circle that they're moving in, but in fact, they may be moving in type of a yin-yang deal, which would obviously explain why they can be in the sky at the same time. And I found that very interesting. And then you look at the yin-yang going way back into ancient Oriental cultures. You know, what did they know? Obviously, they thought the Earth was flat at that time, too. And if you actually do that, a yin yang over that compact disc you have on there, and you just imagine, this is a thought experiment, okay? So you do that, and again, there's the seasons, again, there's the moon and the sun and the in the sky. And here's my other question: why is it that the sun and the moon appear to be the same size? Is that some cosmic coincidence?
Absolutely not. They say that the sun's much further, much bigger than the moon. But they're both the same size. They both operate on these kind of same circuits. And every so often, the moon catches up with the sun for an eclipse. You know, it's very simply laid out when you look at it and see that, you know, it makes sense that it would be winter in the southern. Oh, wrap your head around this. The word south has the word out in it. And so the outer ring is the south on the flat earth map. Everywhere you go south, you could go, you know, any direction is south, and the middle is the North Pole. So the word south has out in it, meaning it's from an etymological standpoint or an etymology standpoint, you'd say that's a pretty big deal. I thought that was fascinating. So it makes sense that when the sun is circling in its tight circles closer to the North Pole, it's winter in the south, and then when it goes down and it's making its wide circles in the southern hemisphere, or whatever you want to call it, it becomes winter in the northern. So it makes sense, you know?
Yeah, it does. And again, people, you need to kind of go back and really look at the model and kind of understand how the model works, because many people, they're still thinking, oh, you're going to fall off the edge. That is not what the flat earth model looks like. And again, we are surrounded by an ice wall. And then people obviously say, well, I've gone around the entire world. And obviously, look, here's the deal. If you take off from San Francisco and you want to sail across the entire, around the world, okay? If north is right in the center of that DVD, your compass is always pointing to magnetic north. There is no south. So you are sailing, you are always navigating east or west away from magnetic north. So you would be circling, picture this as a thought experiment again, you would be circling that DVD, navigating away from magnetic north, but the distances are so vast, you would never know that you were in a very, very small turn constantly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's so big that you won't be able to notice, you know, and that's where it actually kicks in, because that's kind of the reverse of what they try to tell us, that we're too small to see the curvature. But in that sense, when you're traveling around circumnavigating on the flat plane, you are essentially just going in a circle, and that is because magnetic north.
Yeah, you're always navigating away from magnetic north, obviously, if you're flying or, you know, if you're going toward the North Pole. Here's another thing that I found very interesting and I wanted to ask you about. When I started looking at this, I actually looked at this 10 years ago, but I was so buried in 9/11. And research about some other things that I dismissed it. But having come back to it, I started trying to figure out, with all of our technology today, why was there no circumnavigation north to south, either by land or sea, of the globe, the alleged globe, by anybody? I couldn't find anything that had actually happened. But recently, I noticed that there were a couple people who were going to try it. You know, what's your thoughts on that? Why with all of our technology, has there not been a circumnavigation of the alleged globe north to south?
It's because the flat earth Gleason's map makes perfect sense. And when you can only traverse east and west, you cannot go north and then wrap around I guess essentially on a disc, you could head north and you're just going to pass up the center and keep going south again. But anyway, yeah, the flat earth makes so much sense that when it comes to, we're saying you can't go north or south, forget the north. You cannot go south and then come back around, because the south is the outer ice wall rim of the flat earth. And if, I mean, it sounds absolutely nuts, and I thought so too, but this is the truth, and you just have to research it.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously, you know, I keep thinking, you know, why can't they do it? Because there's a dome there. They absolutely can't go around it. Obviously, they can circumnavigate the flat plane by navigating away from magnetic north, which is interesting. So again, Flat Earth 101, folks, check it all out. I mean, you got to start looking. You can't just take it one thing and dismiss it. You need to start looking at specific pieces, and then you need to start really kind of connecting some dots, and it starts to make a lot of sense. And again, go back to your Bibles. Go back to Scripture. Actually look at what's happening here in this Luciferian matrix, which brings me to want to talk about the moon landings here a little bit, and obviously the absurdities of satellites and things like that. One of the things that bothers me, and I think some people actually, I talked about this a little bit yesterday, and I'm curious if you've looked into this. One of the things that bothers me is the temperatures that they claim are on the moon and even in low Earth orbit. They state that in low Earth orbit, metal, and this is NASA telling us this, a metal plate, when it is obviously not in the sunlight, is roughly about negative 170 degrees Celsius, which is minus 274 degrees Fahrenheit. And I think this is important because we got to wrap our head around NASA as being the liars and the deceivers that they are. So anyway, a metal plate not in the sun is minus 170 Celsius or negative 274 degrees Fahrenheit. That's pretty cold. In the sun, they're saying it's positive 123 degrees Celsius, or that's 253.4 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, they said they went to the moon with 1969 technology. Now, keep in mind that 1969 technology, they went to the moon on technology less sophisticated than your cell phone today. Okay? They went to the moon. How on earth did computer chips, silicone chips, electrical engineering, these types of control systems in computers that they were using in 1969 manage to make that 258,000-mile journey and survive the extreme temperatures? Have you looked at that at all? Because this really bothers me, ODD, because even military-grade spec computer chips, they're stated at minus 55 to 125 degrees plus Celsius, which is 250 degrees Fahrenheit. On a 258,000-mile journey, and they're at 250-degree Fahrenheit, I mean, this stuff should be blowing up, right?
Absolutely. This stuff is out there, and a lot of people don't know it and they don't think about it. But all this stuff boils down to is the more you look into it, the more ridiculous it gets, and it can't be justified. I can't sit here. You know, I have looked into it, but there's no way I can't come to the conclusion that this stuff would be operational at those temperatures and flying around like that at 17,000 miles per hour and them being able to dock stuff at those speeds to those, like to the space station and get supplies there. Like, it's just all ludicrous.
Mm-hmm. I think it is ludicrous because I was seriously looking at this stuff because I obviously have a lot of music equipment. Sometimes it's being transported and it's hot. I'm concerned about the electronics in those things either getting cold or getting hot. And I mean, not just the electronics, ODD, but think about the people. How are these people on the moon? And they say in the sun, on the moon, it's about 240 degrees Fahrenheit. How on earth were these guys surviving in those suits? How is the electronics surviving? It doesn't make any sense. It's completely absurd.
It's all BS, and that's just a fact. And what we're looking at is now we're in the year 2017 where they got this thing called the Van Allen radiation belt. I mean, it's been around a long time, but now they're claiming that the Van Allen radiation belt is unpass-throughable for humans, you know, right now, and we got to keep testing it and try to figure out the right technology to get humans through so we can explore deep space. And they say they want to go to places like the moon and Mars and stuff, and
NASA's admitting they can't do it.
Yeah, right. Yeah, they with 1969 technology they did it, but now they can't. Doesn't make sense.
You guided me right into a clip that I want to play. This is Alan Bean, he was allegedly the, I'm not sure, the fourth or fifth man on the moon. This was from a clip from Astronauts Gone Wild, and it's interesting what he says here. This is Alan Bean.
They hadn't been discovered yet. Hadn't been discovered yet.
He's talking about the Van Allen radiation belts.
It hadn't been discovered yet, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It just simply wasn't there. And he even says, I don't think we went out far enough to go through the Van Allen radiation belts. But when he was approached and said, look, the Van Allen radiation belts are between 400 and 3,000 miles above the Earth. When he was called on that, he goes, well, I guess then we did go right through them. This is an astronaut here. I mean, he should know whether or not they went through the Van Allen radiation belts. It's just absolutely crazy to me. These people are all lying to us.
Yeah, it's very easy to see. And thinking about all the stuff they try to pass off and they never get, the ISS trying to dock something at 17,000 miles per hour. Imagine that alone. And your argument that the temperatures and all that stuff, these are the things we need to really be talking about with people, because it becomes crystal clear that this is all nonsense and we really don't have any answers for what they're doing. But what's funny to me is that in the flat Earth model, the moon, right? We got the moon much closer. It's here. They're acting like it's, in their deception, it's much further and they have to basically go past the dome to get there, but it's already here. I just figure that maybe it's, I don't think you could actually land man on that thing, whatever the moon may actually be. It might not be physical at all.
Yeah, in fact, Crow 777, we've talked about him before, the lunar wave and all that stuff. That's just some weird stuff. I mean, he doesn't go quite as far as to say that he thinks it might even be a hologram, but he said something ain't right about the moon.
Yeah, something's not right, because you could, there's been occasions where you could see stars and like planets through the moon. And this is even recorded by the Royal Astronomical Institute. And so things like that, you got to take into account, like how the heck is, we could explain it maybe saying that this stuff is actually really in front of the moon in our model, now that we know that all things aren't what we're told. But in their model, you're seeing a star or a planet through the moon. That's, they're saying those things are, much further than the moon. And it's so everything falls apart again. They just have so many problems.
Every now and then I look at some of this stuff and it just makes me laugh. I'm like, and you know what, ODD, is that I went through this awakening and I started realizing this, and it was very, very difficult. But at the same time, now I'm looking back at it and looking at the indoctrination of the heliocentric model, because I am certainly geocentric, and that's biblical, that's scriptural, folks. The heliocentric model, Star Trek, Star Wars, Battlestar Galactica, all these things we were raised with, the science fiction and the movies and Hollywood were, I mean, this was all pre-programming. And gosh, I have to go even far as to say the whole War of the Worlds thing may have actually been a psyop to see how people would react to this invasion. Do you think they might actually be setting us up for some sort of fabricated alien invasion?
Yeah, I believe that's possible. And it seems like every day in the news or something, you hear some famous scientist, for instance, Michio Kaku, he'll come out and say, NASA just discovered, a million more planets, and some of them are Earth-like. And it, with these kind of things, and past couple years, Jimmy Fallon has presidents on his show, and they always come on and discuss aliens and looking into the files that the government keeps from everybody. And it's kind of like these things are subtly conditioning us to be more on the side that, I think aliens are real. They talk about them all the time. Michio Kaku's talking about Earth-like. There has to be life. There just has to be life. So we're going to all be conditioned to this understanding that aliens are real, not to mention the thousands of horrible Hollywood movies that are released with some sort of alien invasion. That's kind of a predictive programming deal in itself. But yes, I do believe they're setting us up for a Project Bluebeam type scenario.
Yeah, and I even think it might even go beyond that, because I do believe in extraterrestrials. I do believe in aliens, but they are not your Star Trek, your Star Wars aliens. They are, in fact, fallen angels right out of Genesis. They are the wickedness from heavenly places that I talked about earlier when I quoted Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. And I'll say that again, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. And I do think that when they come back, they will be perceived as aliens, or they will be portrayed as aliens. You know, many people talk about, you know, if we're trying to communicate, you know, with these big radio antennas and whatnot, and we're trying to communicate out there. And there are physicists that have said, you know, it's best that we keep our mouth shut if, in fact, there are these types of things out there. But also C.S. Lewis was quoted as saying, and I can't find it at the present moment, so I'm going to paraphrase. Now, here it is. C.S. Lewis was quoted as saying, let's pray that the human race never escapes Earth to spread its iniquity elsewhere. Obviously, he was a Christian. And speaking of the humanity and the fact that we are engaged in this Luciferian agenda, and that evil is, you know, it's forthcoming with humanity. And the only way that we can try to stay in touch with our morals, our goodness, our faith, and helping and concern and compassion and understanding, and most importantly, love, is to stay in touch with God. And I think that's, you know, I think he was talking, let's hope we never escape the Earth. But again, I don't know if we can escape the Earth, ODD.
Yeah, either do I. And I do have a big problem with them trying to disconnect us from, you know, creation and creator. It's just, it doesn't do the mind any good. And I was going down the wrong path. I my life has changed because of the flat Earth and how I look at things now. I've been humbled, and everything is much different, and I appreciate things. And I do know that there is a much higher power looking at everything that's going on. And this, you know, it's just absolutely wild. But yeah, we can't leave. Bill Nye admits that we can't leave. That's the funny thing, is you never know when to take these scientists seriously, but sometimes they say things, or I don't know why they say them, but Bill Nye was quoted saying that, I want your generation to embrace the fact that Earth is an enclosed system. We can't leave the Earth. Isn't that wild?
Yeah, why would Bill Nye say something like that when, you know, even for me, listening to Neil deGrasse Tyson, I was shocked that they allowed him to say it was an oblate spheroid. But then Bill Nye says the same thing, and it's like, what in the world? Is it, you know, just hidden in plain sight?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, these guys are actors. You could look them up, watch videos of people exposing them as being nothing more than these kind of figureheads because they're popular. People like Neil deGrasse Tyson, he's good at talking. And, you know, Bill Nye was signed on by like Disney or something to be a comedian. And that's all he ever really has ever been. And people don't really recognize these things.
Absolutely. ODD, we're about out of time. I'm going to actually leave everybody with They Live, We Sleep. But before we do, I'd like you to tell everybody about where they can reach you and your YouTube channel.
All right, cool. Go on YouTube, type in ODD TV or Odd Reality, and I will surely pop up and just check out some of my stuff. Thanks.
Thank you, brother, for being on the show again. Look forward to meeting you in November, and we'll talk soon. Much love, and God bless you.
All right, God bless.
Bye-bye. This is They Live, We Sleep by ODD.
Yeah. ODD TV. Payday Monsanto. Let's get it, homie.
Time to wake up to the deceit. Our whole reality's made up by the elite. They live, we sleep. The alarm's going off, beep, beep. Time to wake up to the deceit. Our whole reality's made up by the elite.
They live, we sleep. The alarm's going off, beep, beep. Time to wake up to the deceit. Our whole reality's made up by the elite. They live, we sleep. The alarm's going off, beep, beep. Time to wake up to the deceit. Our whole reality's made up by the elite.
I came here to kick some ass just like Roddy Piper. These motherfuckers that walk among us, they got me hyper. But don't be chewing that bubble gum, it's got aspartame. It's a chemical directly targeted at your brain, just like the fluoride that they put in the water supply and all the geoengineering we got in the sky. I'm trying to tell you, and I hope that you're hearing me clearly. This ain't no bullshit speculation conspiracy theory. They live and they're controlling every move you make, from the apartment that you live in to the juice you drink. They give you television to help you ignore this prison while feeding you genetically modified organisms. They want us like the Walking Dead, just obey and consume. Don't worry about anything. Keep away.
Everybody check out ODD TV, Odd Reality on YouTube. Until next week, we've got Ben Cochran joining us as well as Vic Nama. We're going to be talking about allopathic healthcare next Saturday at 2 p.m. Pacific. Much love. God bless. Peace out.